I'm Frank le Duc, and I'm joined today by three of Brighton and Hove's political heavyweights who, apart from their passion in all things Brighton and Hove, are united for a passion in housing. We have Mike Weatherley, the MP for Hove. We have Steve Bassam, Chief Whip in the House of Lords for Labour, and the leader of Brighton and Hove City Council, Bill Randall. I wanted to start by looking at the highs and lows of 2011, and it's been a momentous year in local politics here, not least with the Greens winning control of the council for the first time. So I guess when I ask you what the highs and lows of 2011 are, I can probably guess half the answer.
Yes, it was winning control of the council for the first time, not just in Brighton and Hove, but anywhere in the United Kingdom, by a first-past-the-post system. There are Greens in coalitions all over Europe, but I was at a conference recently where they were astonished we'd done it by first past the post. And of course that followed on a year after Caroline Lucas winning our first parliamentary seat. So yeah, the elections were the high for us this year.
Without wishing to introduce doom and gloom into the conversation, what's the low point of the year politically?
I haven't had a really low point politically. I mean, we were going on to the budget in a minute, but we knew we were going to have to do that. Everything's a challenge. It's a great privilege to be doing what we're doing, and we see it all as a challenge.
Steve, a high point for you this year?
Not too many high points, really, locally. We didn't do very well in the local elections, although we took seats off the Tories, which is always a good thing. We lost seats to the Greens, which is always a bad thing, because in many ways they're politically similar to us, but they're also dissimilar. But I think a lot of challenges for Labour in the city. I think next year is going to be one where we start to make more of a mark, and I'm always very optimistic, and I think that we can begin to turn around our political fortunes, not just here but nationally, and national politics is where I play a bigger part. So I watch things very carefully in Brighton and Hove, usually appalled, but nevertheless I watch them very, very carefully indeed.
And a high point this year for you, Mike? I mean, last year was the high point, really, personally, but...
A high point for me politically in the year, of course, was to get squatting onto as a criminal act onto the statute book subject to the what's going through the House of Lords at the moment. I guess that's a high point for the city as well, because I think that will actually help us in this city. Low points would be an international one, and that would be the EU debt crisis, but also nationally, the riots, and that was clearly a low point in the year. But again, a high point for Brighton, because we didn't have those riots here, so I was very pleased we didn't. So that was kind of a high point amongst all that low point.
And what do you look forward to, or what do you expect next year politically in Brighton and Hove?
Well, next year is going to be quite interesting. It's going to be a lot of to-ing and fro-ing. And I think there'll be, forgive me if I say this to the leader of the council, but I think a lot of the vote that went to the Greens were let's give them a chance. I think there'll be a lot of settling down of that, where people will go back to traditional parties after they see some of the policies going through. That'll be locally. Nationally, of course, everyone knows it's going to be a bit tough and we're going to have to tighten our belts. And there will be some shift between where some of the money's going. And that will be difficult for some people, but unfortunately a necessary thing.
I'm guessing that Bill's going to disagree with you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I don't think it was a question of give the Greens a chance. We've been working steadily for a long time at the vote, and it's come to fruition. And I think people take us seriously. I don't think we're seen as a second choice, have a go after the Tories and Labour. I think this is a critical time for Labour. If we get it right over the next 4 years, I think Labour will be a busted flush in this city.
And again, I dare say that's the point you disagree with?
I think we've got a real challenge, actually. I've always thought that. I thought my colleagues on the City Council and in the local party were wrong not to take the Green Party more seriously 10, 11 years ago. Mm. And that was their big error. The Greens are sort of, in theory, like us, but in practice not. And their priorities are similar to us. If you look at our two manifestos, they're very similar indeed. What they're now finding is the hard part of it, actually. I mean, you know, they've just announced an appalling cuts programme for this city, which, really worries me.
Well, I'm challenging that.
Hold on a sec, because I'm going to put my point of view over here. It's an appalling cuts programme. You know, it's on a par with what the Tories were doing before.
That's
what this city actually needs is a visionary group of politicians who are concerned to ensure that we have a city that continues with the vision that we built up over the, you know, over the 90s and into the early 2000s, that grasps the fundamentals of the local economy, that begins to grow that economy, that provides opportunities for people, that ensures that, you know, we've got good quality schools, good quality public services. These guys, I think, are naive in what they're doing. And worse than that, you know, they're whacking up council tax at a time when people are really genuinely hard-pressed and feeling it in their pockets. And they're hitting business as well. Now, that isn't good for Brighton and Hove. It's not where we're coming from. I can understand, you know, why they're doing it, but I don't think they're doing it in the right way at all.
Can I just answer some of those
points?
Please do. Well, I'd like to answer the one about business. We actually have a very good dialogue going with business, and we are promoting business very well at the moment in the city. And we're bringing European money into the city, which has a lot of European money.
So why are you increasing their parking charges astronomically?
Our parking charges in Brighton are lower than most other places in Sussex. We haven't raised all of them. Some of them have been raised. We've cleared up the mess of parking charges that your party left, where people didn't know if they were coming or going because there were so many different charges.
So the result is just to tax them a lot
more. No, it's not. That's not true of everybody. Some people suffer, not everybody. And if I can go back to what Steve was saying about business, we have a much better relationship with the business community than the Conservatives did before us. The business community did not trust the Conservatives.
That's your perception, and it's entirely wrong.
It's not my perception. Go and talk to people. We are doing very well with the business community. And as for the city needing a group of politicians with a vision, do you actually think you've got those in your party at the moment? You suffered a real defeat in the last local election, which your leader thought you were going to win. She led you to a humiliating defeat, and she's still the leader. Where's the other talent in your party to follow her? Her reward for failure is to continue to lead your party further and further into the wilderness.
Well, I don't think that has to be the case. I mean, let's get this right. What happened in Brighton over a long period of time was that essentially the progressive, liberal, middle-class vote went from the Labour Party towards the Green Party.
And why did they do that?
Well, I think those are good questions to ask, actually, and it's an interesting debate to have. But what I think that people are beginning to discover now is that there's a false prospectus there, because many of the things that liberal, middle-class, previously Labour voting, Brightonians and people from Hove have enjoyed, are now going to be seriously undermined by the sorts of policies that are being adopted and pushed through by what is supposedly a progressive and green council. And I don't see it that way. And I think some of the things you're doing are very divisive and very dangerous and not good for the longer term. And you know, what worries me about the city is it has lost its way over the last decade. And you know, the idea of having an exciting, buzzy, eclectic city by the sea, that the vision of creating a more homogeneous city, one that people could invest in and feel a part of, I think is in some danger from what I see as being a rather narrow politic. Now, I think the fact that there's an emphasis on the environment was always something that was a shared value between the Greens and the Labour Party, not particularly the Tories, but certainly with our two parties. And we haven't, I think, in the past engaged in a sufficiently robust dialogue with Green councillors. And I think that what you're doing now is you're saying one thing in your manifesto and you're having to do something completely different.
Absolutely not the case.
Just like the Liberal Democrats.
Absolutely not the case.
Steve, can I just come in there and just ask one question? You talked earlier about asking for a strategic vision for the city, and indeed, I think many people would say when you were leader of the council, if one thing you had was a strategic vision for Brighton and subsequently Brighton and Hove. How would you define your strategic vision for Brighton and Hove?
Well, we've laid it down in the manifesto very clearly. But if I could just go back to what Steve was saying about...
you've not answered the question.
No,
what's
I want to answer one of your questions first, and that was about what we're doing with the budget. What we're doing with the budget is what we said we would do, and that's protect the most vulnerable people in the city. One of the reasons you've lost votes is because you've ceased to represent those people.
Well, I don't think that's right. Well,
it's absolutely true. If you look at your vote, it's declined enormously. And if we'd had more people to put out on the council estates, we'd have taken more seats than you, and we will next time. Go on to the second bit about the vision for the city. Our vision for the city is clear. We want it to be a green city, of course, but it has to be economically successful as well. And we have worked very hard on several fronts on this. You might remember Steve, and by the way, Steve is absolutely right about the Labour Party not taking it seriously enough, although he did. I know that you personally did all those years
ago. You wouldn't be in control now if we'd taken it as seriously as you did when I was around.
But you didn't convince, unfortunately for you, Steve, you didn't convince your colleagues. But we do realise that you saw this coming. We do believe that economically we've got to make the city a success. Now, we do have a plan B as a city, which started, of course, before us. We're not just a seaside town. We have 1,500 digital companies. We have 16,000 people working creative industries. You might remember... started an inquiry into environmental industries in this city. We're never going to make wind turbines or solar panels, but the research and development we are good at. There's about 90 to 100 companies working in that field now, and we're encouraging them. We're a diverse city, which is very, very important. 84% of the companies in this city are 10 people or fewer. We are doing everything we can to help those companies.
See, Bill, you always go back to your green credentials, which is an easy one to do, because everyone loves cuddly, you know, trees and solar panels and so forth.
Which
and
is why you put a tree on your logo, of course.
Well, that's to show sustainability and so forth, absolutely.
Would you say that the things you've been saying in the last week you any credibility on the sustainability front, right?
Well, I would say that we will be the greenest government ever. But see, let me just finish my point. This is exactly what the Greens do, is they go back to the one bit that people can identify and say solar panels, cycle lanes, that's great. As soon as it comes to any serious policies, you fall down really badly.
Absolute nonsense.
Of course it's not nonsense.
It is absolute nonsense.
You're going to tax us out of the heavens for
we're
no
not
going to
tax
reason.
You out of the heavens.
Some of your policies are completely bonkers, you know.
I don't accept that at all.
Well, okay, we can disagree perhaps on that. But as soon as you go outside your Greens safe
zone,
and also come back to the democracy point, you're on about first past the post and so on. In the last general election, the Conservatives got 48,000, the Labour's 47,000, the Liberals 27,000, the Greens only got 20,000. So under proportional representation, you wouldn't even have a representative now.
We were working under the system that was there.
And also, I would say that when you have three candidates in a particular ward for... you do it very cleverly in the Greens, you put your first preference candidate. So when someone wants to do a protest, they don't separate it out. I think that's a smart move, because you can then sneak in when someone wants to do a protest vote. And that's what's happened in a number of areas, which I think you're going to lose those.
I think that
will gradually come down.
Well, we're seeing the by-election, won't we?
Well, yeah, I mean, just the council tax is an absolute prime example. All your excuses for not wanting to take the government money is completely ridiculous, absolutely ridiculous, because you could put it up 7% in a year's time. You choose not to because you'll need a referendum to do that. And you knew you won't. You know you won't get the backing of the people to do
that. That's not why we're doing it this way.
Do you see the Westbourne by-election as a vote of confidence in what you're trying to do?
Well, I don't know. I mean, it's a Tory seat. But I think we've got a really good chance of winning it, yeah.
And would you see that as a vote of, as a sort of test of, yes, we do want what the Greens are doing, or, crikey, we didn't expect this?
This is a three-party town. You've got two
it's
sort
a
of centre-left...
three-party by-election as well.
You've got three parties. You've got two centre-left parties who are competing for largely the same pool of votes. I mean, Bill's party don't take a lot of votes off the Tories, by and large. I mean, they do take some, but not that many. It's mostly...
We run some seats off them in the last...
Well, yeah, but you...
That protest third vote, you're quite right.
You won those seats... I think it might have something to do with the way your government is treating people.
The demographics of Brighton
Hove... And that will be reflected in Westbourne as well.
The Brighton Hove demographics changing, though, isn't it?
It is,
it's getting younger, and you've got more graduates.
This is a progressive centre-left city, and it's the electoral system that does actually deliver two seats to the Tories... And one to the Greens, because the core of the city is a progressive centre-left electorate, and that will always be the case. Even with a boundary shift, that will be the case. In fact, it may well even be consolidated. So that's the fact of it. This by-election is a genuine three-way contest. It's a Tory-held seat, and the seats that you took off the Tories are by and large seats which I think probably in good years we would have taken off them previously. I mean,
Withting?
Yeah, I think so. Yeah, I mean, looking at the demographics and the political mix.
But you didn't.
We didn't know. No. But there's a reason for that. But the reason for that is that there are two parties competing for the same or a very similar pool of votes. So this by-election is an important test for the Green administration. I happen to agree with Mike on the issue of local taxation. I think they're wrong because, in essence, they're having to load more cuts as a product of not taking money from central government in this financial year. And I don't think that's the right thing to do. The figures are not precise in my head, but they're going to have to load in more budget saving or generate more income. And I don't think they've been imaginative enough in doing that either. But, without having the feel for the detail, I can see what they're trying to do, but I think their approach is rather naive and I think it's wrong. And I suspect that in future years, the government's going to make it much more difficult for them. And then the level of cuts and savings that they have to make are going to be magnified.
Yes, I think, could we just
Can we draw?
You can't disagree.
No, we draw a hold there. We'll come back.
I can disagree with you on that, and we might go back to the foundation of all this as well, which are the cuts imposed by this government on the local authority.
You just want to spend more and more and more. You've got to have some idea of saying
that's
spending and borrowing and so on.
That's simply not true.
We are making taxing out of people out of existence. Well, you can't keep borrowing out of your existence.
There are other ways of doing it, aren't there? There's your Trident vanity project, which you pursue.
That's not a Brighton Hove project, guys. That's not a Brighton Hove project.
People of Britain. Sick and tired of Christmas shopping, bored with the same old black and white repeats on the television or wireless, then why not take up the new craze of occupying things? That's right. From Wall Street to St. Paul's Cathedral, people are occupying things like they've never occupied things before. It's the hip thing to do, Daddy-O, and no mistake. But beware. You must know why it is you're occupying the thing you're occupying before you decide to occupy that thing. There's nothing worse than occupying something when one hasn't a belly clue why one is occupying the thing one is occupying. That's a recipe for what have you, and can lead to all forms of nastiness, including sexual confusion, malnutrition, and being beaten over the head by a Ross's truncheon after being kettled into a corner full of student wee. Ooh. Most people who occupy things don't know why they're there. They just follow the crowd, assuming it's a cue for the bog. That makes life terribly difficult for the good old-fashioned British bobby. The poor, often criticised, helpless local constable, armed only with his automatic submachine gun and his taser. Which is why Her Majesty's Government is asking all these long-haired delinquents who are currently occupying tourist spots and upsetting our beloved bankers, God bless them, and asking them to occupy somewhere else instead. But where, I hear you ask? Well, the answer is simple. Prison cells. Yes, Mr. David Cameron and his glamorous assistant, Nicola Clegg, are more than happy for these work-shy types to occupy prison cells for as long as they like. Yes, you see? The coalition government does have a heart after all.
The global economy is in recession. People are making their views known about the failures of capitalism in Wall Street and now outside St. Paul's Cathedral in London. In Brighton, protesters have joined the movement with Occupy Brighton. We've been to Victoria Gardens, where there are 20 to 30 tents, to find out why people are there and what they've got to say. Is there anything that can really be changed by a camp like this, what's the aim of being here?
I think what we should be doing is listening to them and then thinking about what we should be doing.
There are signs up saying we're the 99%, but what can be done to get the message just out beyond a small sort of core of supporters?
I think it's probably a mistake to think that there's got to be a kind of mass presence here all the time. That's just not, it's not really what it's about. It's about having a presence. Sometimes on the General Assembly, if you come in the evening, there'll be a crowd here.
Do you think if anything can be achieved by being here, or what are your hopes for Occupy Brighton?
We're trying to embarrass the government out of their nonsense. Clearly, we cannot go on the way we are going on now. It's not working. Educated people find themselves homeless and unemployed, like me. The financial system of capitalism, which Adam Smith advocated in 1776, is no longer working the way it should, and it needs adjusting. How you do that and what it's going to be adjusted to is something for discussion, and that's what we talk about.
Some people have criticised the fact that you're on a sort of public space, that you're visible, that they think it's not a very sort of easy on the eye.
We would like to be in more comfortable circumstances, so why don't you open up a nice conference hall and a place where people can sleep and so on for us to do that.
Latest TV with Geoffrey Theobald, the leader of the Conservative Opposition Group on Brighton and Hove City Council. And I wanted to ask you about the encampment at Victoria Gardens.
These gardens are gardens to be enjoyed by everybody in the city, not by people camping there day after day. And we don't know how long they will camp for, and they could grow and grow. But as I've already said, this has very, very little to do with Brighton and Hove.
They're obviously very concerned about things like unemployment and poverty and the state of capitalism, and whether we agree with them or not. They have a right to have their say. Where should they have that say?
Well, I'm a Democrat, and obviously I wouldn't wish to stop free speech. This is something that is very, very important for all of us. I also don't wish to put more of a burden on London, but obviously these issues are decided in capital cities. This is where our parliament lays. You can make your point quite quickly, and you don't have to make it over 3, 4, 5, 6 weeks, or even 6 months.
We've heard from one or two views in the debate there, both about the problems with global capitalism, why people are protesting, and whether in fact they should be protesting in the centre of Brighton at all. A lot of views to juggle, and we'll leave it to you to make up your minds on this big issue. That was a film about Occupy Brighton, which we shot recently. And with Occupy Brighton in the news, protests about bankers and capitalism, disputes over travellers, strikes, squatting back in the news, youth unemployment rising. Are we back to the 70s? Are we back to the 30s? Mike?
Well, I went down to visit the Occupy protesters recently. And really, they're just an anti-capitalist, anti-government type organisation. And they don't really have any central views of what should be doing, other than it's wrong and we don't like the result that was voted for. We don't like the democracy, therefore we're going to protest. Now, I'm actually all in favour of people having a bit of a protest and putting some banners up, especially if they're bringing a new point to the table. But to spend ages there, and I said to one of the protesters, how long are you going to be here? They said, well, as long as it takes. I said, could that be 5 years? And he said, if it's 5 years, that's what it takes, it should be. I said, well, in that case, you're using the health service, you're using the libraries, you're using the collections. Why should you not be paying for that and the rest of the citizens of Brighton and Hove be paying for that? Surely that's wrong. They said, well, we want to represent their views. And I said, no. The views of the people of this city were to their elected representatives. In my case, I'm representing the ones of Hove and Portslade, and we don't want to see them there permanently. We don't want to see them there for 5 years. I don't want to see them there for another day. They've made their point. I don't think it's a valid point. The 99% of the people they say they represent, I think 99% of the people would like them to leave now, thank you.
Could they be doing something more productive elsewhere at the moment, that more helpful in a place where we've got plenty of need?
They are protesting, peacefully protesting. I have to say, I've not had one complaint about the camp, and we are negotiating an exit for them. We have tolerated them being there. They've had recycling bins there, they've looked after their waste, actually cleaned up the area around them after the white night. I've not had any complaints. We will
but
talk
about
them
their
for,
conduct and their behaviour, yeah, as opposed to the fact that they're...
Sorry to
and
dive
the,
in.
And, the poli- you... and the, if I might say, the, we talked to the police about them this week, and the police echoed that view. The police
you
have
don't
not
have
had
the complaints because people know you are tolerating them. But the people I talked to a couple yesterday who've got 2 children, 6 and 8, and they say they don't go down there because their children feel intimidated. That's not right. It's a public park. They should be able to use that. Old ladies should be able to walk their dogs there. It's not a place for protest. It's there to move on. Don't use
well,
it as a free
sorry,
site.
You may have had a complaint. I've had none. And that park, by the way, I have to say, which is something we'd like to do more with, is a bit like a central reservation in a motorway at the moment. It's not used greatly. But I've not had any complaints. We allow peaceful protest. You've said you support people peaceful protest. The last leader of the Tories in Brighton did, and I know that Steve does as well.
And the ones I've met there have been very charming and nice. So I you know, they've been nice people, but at the end of the day, it is a place that's not for protesting.
I think, Mike, all of the things that Frank mentioned earlier, I'd separate travellers out from that because that's a perennial problem. That's not a response to anything the government's doing.
I remember interviewing Steve about travellers when
I was
young.
In terms of the basket of other things you're talking about, yes. I don't think that goes in there. We can talk about travellers in a minute.
I think that,
but I think
two
I
things.
Think,
the reason they're connected, I think, for me, I think,
there
is the fact that they're in a public space.
Okay, but there is dissatisfaction
for a different
in
reason.
This country with what is happening. We know the situation we're in. I was at a meeting recently where a senior civil servant said, get used to this. This is the reality for the foreseeable future. We're looking at the next comprehensive spending review already, and you can expect more of this. He also told me the only two areas this government thinks they can cut are overseas aid and local government. The rest is pretty untouchable.
You're saying you should give in to
Hang
mob
on a second.
Rule, and that's just wrong.
I'm not saying that. What I'm saying is you should be... You do need to understand that while people see we're in difficulties, they also see the way you're dealing with it is totally unfair.
So and in it is the 60% box, vote us out afterwards.
Yeah, next time that will happen. The 60% of people who are on the lowest incomes in this country are supporting the cuts that you're making, and the people at the top are getting
wrong
away with it.
Obviously.
Well, I think
Steve's done Bill's job here. How would you handle this situation with a camp set up in the middle of Brighton? How do you feel about
it? I don't think that this notion that the Greens have of a protest city, I don't think is a particularly viable one. I suppose it might bring some sort of weekend protesters. I can well understand why the camp's there. I can well understand why the protesters are outside St Paul's Cathedral. Should they be there long term in a public place? Probably not. I think probably after a while they'll fade away. But they've made a very valid point, and I'm with them in spirit. I mean, I'm well past wanting to get my sort of sleeping bag out of my bedroll and go down there. But you know, when I've sort of led protest movements or been involved in the past, you know, it's exactly the sort of thing you would do. And I think it's a measure of a tolerant society that we leave these things alone. I mean, I recently went to Washington, and there's a rather scruffy-looking protest outside the White House, and I thought to myself, I've seen this before, it's outside the House of Commons. You know, and it happens the world over, and that's what should happen in a democracy. We should allow people that space to profoundly object. I think that Bill is absolutely right is that we're going to have to get used to the fact this is going to be a continuing thing. But the government is storing up so many points of conflict and so many opportunities for people to protest and object to things, you know, right across the piece, whether it's unemployment, youth unemployment, cuts to welfare, cuts to benefits that disabled people need, whether it's, you know, all the other misplaced priorities that
it's
they've
called
got.
Living within your means. I mean, we're spending so much under the Labour government. We're paying for that. £120 million a day in interest. Everyone knows we have to live within our means, and you know that. Not cuts. It's just trying to
I'm a hard-nosed politician, and I believe that we should live within our means. But I think what the government's doing with its deficit reduction programme, actually expanding the deficit this year and still claiming they're going to be reducing the deficit by 2016 seems to me absolutely ludicrous. I think, you know, to have turned our economy around from one that was beginning to grow to one that's going into recession again is pretty remarkable in 18 months. And they're doing it faster than any previous Tory government. That's why we're going to have more protest movements.
What can we do to mitigate the effects of that on Brighton Hove?
Well, in terms of protests.
He wants the cuts to be deeper.
I don't want people to suffer. Of course we don't. But at the end of the day, you've got to live within your means. We don't want to be a Greece or an Italy and have the whole meltdown and no one investing and
we
having high interest rates and so on. You've got to build up from a base again. And if you don't have confidence in your
economy.
You've
got to do it fairly. And it's not being unfairly.
If you don't
at the
actually
moment.
Have something Precisely. To encourage
the poor
and to
are paying
get the,
more than the rich for this.
See, you just want to tax
no,
and spend.
I don't want
and
tax
borrow
and spend.
And it's just
what
just
I'm saying
wrong
is, Mike.
But you're
There's
taxing
not enough pain
and
at
you're
the top
spending
and
the wrong, on the wrong
that.
Things. That's Bill's
Tax
point.
Tax the rich, soak the rich, and then let them all move out and don't have any revenues. I mean, I'm not saying that you're saying that, Dale, and that's what the Greens are saying. It's just the wrong
Do
policy.
Do you really believe we're all in this together, Mike?
I believe that
Do
we
you
should
you
have...
answer my question?
Do
you really believe
everyone
we're all in this together?
Everyone's part of this country,
really?
Absolutely, and we're all going to be suffering
the City
for all
of London?
The...
Who bankrolled you at the last election?
If you're going to ask
way.
A question, but you've got to allow someone to answer. But I don't want to be in a position where everyone in Italy is suffering and everyone in Greece is suffering. In this country, we want to build up our businesses again and have a strong economy. And you're not going to do that by forever taxing people more and borrowing more and just saying, we'll spend our way out of it.
You're not building up business. It's just not possible.
One of the things we need to do then, obviously, if we want to tackle things like youth unemployment and again, build the economy, is get people back into work. What can be done locally to get people back into work? We've got two universities and two colleges that turn out three colleges that turn out people at 18 and beyond. What can we do to make sure that the rise in youth unemployment doesn't worsen any more than it is likely to?
Well, there's no doubt that youth unemployment is a serious issue, and I do welcome what the government's done on the apprenticeships. I think the headlong rush to get 50% of people into university was a mistake because it wasn't thought out about how it should be funded or how the country could afford it. And we kind of moved away from some of the traditional industries, especially some of the apprenticeship ways of doing it. I do think that's the way forward, and certainly in Brighton and Hove we could do that. I mean, we do have a vibrant economy here. We do, as Bill said earlier, have a lot of businesses that are ready and poised to take part of any increases, and especially the proximity of London. So that combined, you know, our creative industries, our technological industries.
But if your policies were working, how is it that in Hove, the last set of statistics I saw, there was a 127% increase in people between the age of 18 and 24 falling to be unemployed. Now, if your policies were working and we were regenerating, we were growing our economy, you know, we wouldn't have that sort of level of problem.
No, you make a fair point. We've only been in government 18 months, and if in 5 years we still had the same number of increase, I would say to you that we should have done far better on that. And I think we should do far better on youth unemployment. And I think we've just recently made a whole bunch of announcements that will make it a lot better.
Like what?
Well, all the apprenticeships, and you
but
saw Nick Clayton's.
That looks like smoke and mirrors for the
Well, if it is smoke and mirrors.
I hope you're right.
No,
I hope it's true.
I agree with you. If it is smoke and mirrors, then I'll be the first to be complaining about it. I'll be first to holding the government to account. Because we've got to get rid of that unemployment malaise that people under 25 are getting into the habit of not working.
I'm sure we'll all agree on that.
Mike's talking a little bit about national issues. Yeah, but can I just say that
one of the signs of hope for creating some employment was through the feed-in tariffs. And there were companies in this city who'd geared up to do that.
So you
work.
Go straight back to your green sort of thing. You don't do the overall thing.
It's not just about... Feed-in tariffs are not just about green values. They're also about providing employment and training to do the work, about cutting fuel poverty, also cutting fuel bills generally, and making people healthier because they live in warm houses. The green argument quite often...
It was hugely successful, which is why it had to be finished earlier. That's why.
Because you got it wrong anyway. If the green argument is quite often attached, nearly always attached, to other economic arguments, health and wellbeing arguments across the piece.
Bill, that's one sector of the local economy. I mean, I'm asking the question partly because I'm aware that you have taken a strong interest in apprenticeships that Mike was talking about.
Yes, I have, yeah.
What is the council doing to help youth unemployment?
Well, there are, of course, the apprenticeships that have been created through the partnership with Mears. We've just actually started work on the local development agency. And there'll Brighton and Hove Seaside Community Aid. Okay. There'll be some apprenticeships through that. I was at a meeting, small things count too. I was at a meeting this morning on Whitehawk Estate, Robert Lodge, which I'm sure you're familiar with, yeah. Steve. I was talking to the tenants, and they have another set of garages there that they want to improve. I suggested to that we should use local young people through City College to do that work. And we're working with City College and Phil Fry, the excellent head of City College, to try and encourage small pieces of work wherever we can.
But they're not going to tackle the fundamentals.
They will help.
I mean, we need investment.
We need investment from the central government in infrastructure projects.
Absolutely right.
That are going to help people.
Absolutely right.
And there is a local enterprise partnership, which has replaced the Regional Development Agency, which we're part of, we're working with, but I'm not quite sure how much that will achieve. And the other thing, can I just say one other thing? We're working with six other local authorities, all of them conservative in the southeast, to better our procurement policies. We are really concerned about all this. If we save money there, we can create more jobs.
The Greens have taken over politically in Brighton and Hove, and now the green industries are growing as well. Here we look at a new trade show that will be taking place at the Amex Community Stadium, the greenest football stadium in the country, in June next year. Perhaps not surprisingly, local Green MP Caroline Lucas welcomes this news. Caroline, what will the Ecotech show mean for Brighton?
I think the Ecotech show will be a real opportunity to showcase best practice in Brighton. Brighton's already known for a really good green track record when it comes to green businesses being based here, green innovation, green behaviour. And I think that the fact that the show is going to be taking place in this city will really enhance all of that green reputation and hopefully extend it. It'll be a real opportunity to showcase best green practice.
How's that going to make a difference to the way we actually live our lives?
I think it'll make a difference in a number of ways. I mean, I think first of all, it's important to say that this is going to attract lots of jobs and investment. It's not a one-off programme. It's going to be happening on an annual basis. So it's an ongoing hub, if you like, and focus of investment in green technologies. And that affects us, ordinary people, if you like, in the way that new green innovation can be brought to market more quickly. There are things like, for example, solar bicycles and the possibility of Brighton being one of the first places to actually make solar bicycles.
Can I ask you about Rampion Wind Farm, the proposals? It's not without its critics. Some people criticise the way it looks or the potential effect on marine life, and whether even it's the most effective way to generate energy. What would you say to those critics?
I would say that we need a toolbox of different renewable energies and energy efficiency if we're going to genuinely move to a greener energy future. And offshore wind definitely has an important part to play in that. You know, in terms of the impact it will have for us here on shore, there's very little actual intrusion for us. But what it will do is create enough energy to be able to power many, many homes across the city and beyond. It's a very practical way of doing that. It's not to suggest that every bit of renewable energy in Britain should come from wind, not at all. We need investment in solar, we need investment in ground source heat pumps, we need a whole range of combined heat and power and other technologies. But it has a role to play, and I'm really excited it's going to be there based off Brighton.
What I'd like to do now is ask our guests to nominate people for political awards in Brighton and Hove in 2011. I'd like to start the ball rolling by nominating Brian Fitch, who for more than two decades I've been writing about as veteran councillor Brian Fitch, until he lost his seat in the local elections 4 years ago. This May he won it back. So for comeback kid of the year, I'd like to nominate veteran councillor Brian Fitch. Mike, who would you nominate?
Well, telling a cheap one, I would nominate Roger French as the most petulant outburst of the year when I was suggesting that Brighton Hove buses should have some competition, and he did a bit of a rant in the evening in the Argus, which was a bit petulant in my view. But on a more serious note, I guess there's two people I'd like to nominate for award. Would be Laurette Mackayo, who lives in Port Slade, for a tremendous work she does in the community, and the Off the Fence organisation from the homeless charity who are in Portland Road. They have a very sensible approach to what they do, and they do a lot for the city.
Bill?
Well, a serious award, which might surprise you, I'd nominate Brian Oxley, Conservative councillor who's just stood down in Westbourne, and who, in my experience, has always been a thoughtful and courteous opponent.
Absolutely.
Very bright politically. Great loss, in fact, the Conservative group on Brighton and Hove City Council, and a thoroughly decent man. So I would nominate Brian. He's on the different side to me, but a good man all round, I think. Other awards, well, there's a woman called Margaret Lucas, who is the chair of the Residence Committee on the Queen's Park Estate, the Packhurst Avenue Estate. And she, for the last 8 years, has worked ceaselessly for that estate. And when I first got involved, there was an organisation called the Packhurst Crew, yes, which is a local gang, who, by the way, had, I don't know if they still do, an old boys page on their website. And you think if they can do that, why can't they use that imagination somewhere more positively? Sure. Margaret has fought really hard for her community. We've had some successes. We've got a little community hub up there now. She has at times had personal threats. They've gone away now. I would really like to nominate her. And if I was to nominate an organisation, I think it would be RISE, who do a terrific job. And I went to their Living Library event last week and heard the testimony of a woman who'd gone through domestic violence. RISE do a really important job in a city with a shameful record of domestic violence.
Indeed. Steve?
I think looking at the community, one of my favourite organisations would be the Brighton Housing Trust and Andy Winter. Mm. I think he's a cracking guy. I've known him for a very, very long time.
Didn't you once throw him out of the party?
Yeah. I didn't personally throw him out of the Labour Party.
He was purged.
No.
He was a poll tax rebel. You purged him.
It was. That's not the point. Brighton Housing Trust is a very good organisation.
Yeah,
Andy
is
a brilliant chief executive. And he and I have known each other through good and bad arguments over a very long period of time. And that's why I actually would nominate him. For joke nomination, I suppose my nomination would be Norman Baker, who I loathe.
Oh, we're all safe on that one.
Because the man clearly is scared, worried, whatever you want to put it, about the prospect of having to fight in a three-way marginal in East Brighton. Lewis and Wivelsfield, I think, is the constituency that should probably be known. And the idea that Norman would make an impact on Brighton politics does amuse me quite a lot.
Well, I'm going to round up by saying I thought he made quite a big impact on Brighton politics during the Falmer Stadium planning process.
A very negative one.
And I've got... He's certainly got the debate running.
He probably cost that stadium 3 or 4 years actually in the making. Yeah.
Representing the people who
representing a small number of people on the edge of his.
I speak as an Albion fan.
Yeah, I know.
but one who admires his campaigning ability and. I guess I'm going to be the one who ops out there and say, actually, I actually quite like Norman, but don't tell anyone. Thank you very much.
People love Brighton and Hove, actually. We've arrived on the cusp of 2012. All well and good, you might say. But what about 2011? What on earth happened there? Well, let's recap, shall we? 2011 was the year in which weather temperatures sunk lower than Kenny Katona, and when it seemed a week couldn't go by without some youths running amok in the shopping malls of the nation, and causing over £1 million worth of improvements to the city of Croydon. All in all, a typical year in 21st century Britain. We also had huge queues of people unable to leave the country because of strikes, huge queues of people unable to leave the country because of snow, and huge queues of people actually leaving the country because David Cameron and Nick Clegg were still running the country. But hold on there, Squire. What about all the terribly spiffing good things that happened in 2011? Things like William and Kate getting spliced, and her not even up the duff. Brighton's first Green MP. Splendid filly. Or the bravery of the protesters in the so-called Arab Spring, even though they're foreign and therefore not technically news. In austerity Britain today, It's not so much a case of keep calm and carry on. More of a case of bob around and carry on panicking.
Thanks for watching our first political show about Brighton and Hove. We'll be back again with more next month.